Bay Area Radio Drama presents Huey by Eugene O'Neill. Directed by Jose Quintero, with Jason Robards as Erie and Jack Dodson as the night clerk. At the conclusion, we will hear a commentary on the play by the eminent O'Neill scholar Travis Bogard. This program was made possible by funding from the National Endowment for the Humanities. Huey by Eugene O'Neill.
Key.
Hmm?
Key. Oh, forgot, sir. You ain't seen me before. Erie Smith's the name. I'm an old-timer in this flea bag. 492.
492. Yes, sir.
Uh-huh. How long have you been on the job? 4 or 5 days now. I've been off on a drunk. Yep, come to now, though. Tapering off. Well, I'm glad they fired that young squirt they took on when Huey got sick. One of them fresh, wise punks, you couldn't tell him nothing. Well, pleased to meet you, pal. I hope you stick around.
Glad to know you, Mr. Smith.
Yeah. What's your name?
Hughes. Charlie Hughes.
Huh? Hughes? Say, is that on the level?
Charlie Hughes.
Well, I'll be damned. What the hell do you know about that? Say, now I notice that you don't look like Huey, but you remind me of him somehow. You ain't by any chance related?
Oh, you mean to the Hughes that worked here so long and died recently?
Yeah.
No, sir. No relations.
Oh, that's right, yeah. Huey told me he had no relations left. Except his wife and kids, of course. Oh, yeah. Poor guy croaked last week. His funeral was what started me off on a bat. Why? Some drunk. Oh, I don't want one often. No, no. Bum dope in my book. Guy gets careless. Gabs about things he knows, and when he comes to, he's liable to find there's guys who'd feel easier if he wasn't around no more. That's the trouble with knowing things. Take my tip, pal. Don't ever know nothing. Be a sap and stay healthy. But I always keep my noggin working. Booze or no booze, I'm no sucker. What was I saying? Ah, yeah, some drunk. I sure hit the high spots. Should have seen the doll I made the night before last. Did she take me to the cleaners? I'm a sucker for blondes. You're married, ain't you?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I laid 10 to 1 on it. You got that old look like Huey had. Maybe that's the resemblance. Kids, too, I bet.
Yes, sir, 3.
You're worse off than Huey was. He only had 2. 3, huh? Well, that's what comes from being careless.
Eddie, the oldest, is 11 now. Where's it 12?
Well, I suppose marriage ain't such a bum racket if you're made for it. Hey, Huey didn't seem to mind it so much, but if you want my lowdown, his wife is a bum in space. Or I don't mean cheap now. With her puss and figure, she'd never make no one except she raided a blind asylum.
Hi, my feet ache. I wish 492 had stopped talking and go to bed.
How old are you? Now, you wait, let me guess. You look 50. Or over, but I'll let you 10 to 1, you're 43, or maybe 44.
I'm 43.
I win, huh? Oh, I sure can call the turn on ages, buddy. You ought to see the dolls get sored up when I pull it on them. Yeah, you're like Huey. He looked like he'd never see 50 again, and he was only 43.
Maybe it is 44.
Me? I'm 45. Never think it to look at me, would you? Most of the dames don't think I've hit 40 yet.
Maybe I ought to get those shoes I see advertised for fallen arches. Yeah, they cost $8, so that's all.
Make another little bet on you. Born and raised in the sticks, wouldn't you?
Well, I come originally from Saginaw, Michigan, but I've lived in the big town so long I consider myself a New Yorker now.
Oh, I don't deserve no medal for picking that one. No. Nearly every guy I know on the big stem, and I know most of them, hails from the sticks. Now, take me. You'd never guess it, but I was dragged up in Erie, P.A. Ain't that a knockout? Erie, P.A.? That's how I got my moniker. No one calls me nothing but Erie. You better call me Erie, too, pal, or else I won't know when you're talking to me.
All right, Erie.
Attaboy. Here's another knockout. Smith is my real name. Broadway guy like me named Smith, that's my real name. Ain't that a knockout? I don't remember nothing much about Erie, P.A., you understand? Or want to. Oh, boy, that was some punk bird. After grammar school, my old man put me to work in his store dealing out groceries. Some punk job. But I stuck it. Yeah, stuck it. Till I was 18 before I took a run-out powder. Speaking of marriage, now that was the big reason I ducked. A doll nearly had me hooked for the old shotgun ceremony. Wow, closest I ever come to being played for a sucker. This doll in Erie, Daisy was her name, one of them dumb, wide-open dolls, all the guys give her a play, that one day she wakes up and finds out she's going to have a kid. Well, I never figured she meant to frame me in particular. Way I figured she didn't have no idea who, so she holds a lottery all by herself. Put about 1,000 guys' names in a hat, all she could remember, drew one out, and I was it. She told her ma, and her ma told her pa, and her pa come around looking for me. Well, I was no fall guy even in those days. I took it on the lam for Saratoga to look the bang tails over. I started to be a horse player back in the area, though I'd never seen a track, and I've been one ever since. And I ain't done so bad, brother. I made some killings in my time the gangs still gab about. I've been the big bucks more than once, and I will be again. Well, of course, I have tough breaks. What the hell, I always get by when the horses won't run for me. There's always draw or stud, and when they're bad, there's a crap game, and when they're all bad, there's always bucks to be picked up from little errands I ain't talking about, which they give to a guy who can keep his clam shut. I get along, buddy. I get along fine.
Yes, sir.
Sorry if I'm keeping you up, sport. Huey was a wide-awake guy. He was always waiting for me to roll in. He'd say, hello, Erie, how the bangtails treat you? How's luck? Or did you make the old bones behave? And then I'd tell him I'd done. He'd ask, what's new along the big stem? And I'd tell him the latest off the grapevine. Sure used to hand me a laugh to hear old Huey cracking like a sport. In all years I've known him, he never bet a buck on nothing. Well, it ain't his fault. No, he'd have took a chance, but how could he with his wife keeping cases on every nickel of his salary? I showed him lots of ways that he could cross her up, but he was too scared, yeah? The biggest knockout was when he used to kid me about dames. He'd crack,
what? No blonde tonight, Erie? You must be slipping.
You never seen a guy more bashful with a doll around than Huey was. Yeah. I used to introduce him to some of the tramps I'd drag home with me. I'd wise them up to kid him along and pretend they fell for him. In 2 minutes, they'd have him hanging on the ropes. Face would get red. Look like he wanted to crawl under that desk there. Ugh, some of them dolls was raw, babies.
Made some pretty raw propositions. He'd stutter like he's paralyzed, but he ate enough just the same as Tickle Pink. Yeah, I used to hope maybe I could nerve him up to do a little cheating. Yeah, I'd offer to fix it up for him with one of my dolls. Hell, I got plenty. I wouldn't have minded. I'd tell him, just let that wife of yours know you're cheating, and she'll have some respect for you. But he was too scared.
Some queens I brought in here in my time, brother. Rails from the follies and the scandals and frolics that would knock your eye out. And I can still make them. You watch. Oh, I ain't slipping.
What job I'd like. I'd bang those cans louder than they do. I'd wake up the whole damn city.
Jesus, what a dummy. Well, might as well hit the hay, I guess.
Good night, Mr. Smith. Hope you have a good rest.
What a crummy dump. What did I come back for? I should have stayed on a drunk. Now, you never guess it, buddy. But when I first come here, this was a classy hotel. Clean, too. I've been camping here off and on for the last 15 years, but I've got a good notion to move out. This place ain't been the same since old Huey got took to the hospital.
How the hell are we going to bed? Yep. Hell, I just lie there worrying. Believe me, brother. Never been a guy to worry. This time I got to, if I ain't a sap.
Well, that's too bad, Mr. Smith, but they say most of the things we worry about never happen.
Yeah, well, this thing happens, pal. I ain't want to bet at nothing since Huey got took to the hospital. I'm jinxed. And that ain't all.
What the hell? You're right. Not, always turns up for me. I was born lucky. Oh, I ain't worried. I'm just moaning low. You know how it is when you're coming off a drunk. Yeah, Brooklyn boys march over the bridge with bloodhounds to hunt you down. Yeah. I'm still carrying the torch for Huey. His checking out was a real KO for me. Damn, if I know why. You know, lots of guys I've been pals with croaked or booze or something or got rubbed out, and I always took it as part of the game. Hell, we all got a croak, huh? Look, here today, gone tomorrow. When a guy's dead, he's dead. He don't give a damn, so why should anybody else, huh? I miss Huey, I guess. I guess I got to like him a lot. Why not? He was ever real pal, you understand? He didn't run in my class. No. Didn't know none of the answers. He was just a sucker. But I sure am sorry he's gone. You missed a lot not knowing Huey, pal. He sure was one grand little guy.
Only so many L trains pass in one night, each one passing leaves one less to pass. But I always tell Jess when she nags me to worry about something. That's life, isn't it? What can you do about it?
Say, you do remind me of Huey somehow, pal. You got that same look on your map.
Suppose it's only the old night clerk look. There's one of them born every minute.
Yeah, Mr. Smith. That's what Barnum said. It certainly is true, isn't it?
Nix on the Mr. Smith stuff, Charlie. There's 10 of them born every minute. Call me Erie, like I told you.
All right, Erie.
Yeah. Huey sure was one grand little guy. All the same, like I said, he wasn't the kind of a guy you'd figure a guy like me'd take to.
because he was a sucker, see? Kind of a sap. He'd take to the cleaners a million times and he'd never wise up. He was tough. Well, night after night, just for a gag, I'd get him to shoot crap with me on the desk here with my dice, and he never asked me to give him the once-over. Can you beat that? Oh, not that I'd ever ring in no phonies on a pal. Oh, God, I'm no heel. Anyway, I didn't need any to take Huey because he never made me knock him against nothing. Just, roll him on the desk here. Oh, boy. Better let me throw that way in a real game, I'd be worth $10 million. You know, you'd have thought that Huey'd got wise that something was out of order. And no matter how much he'd win on a run of luck like suckers have sometimes, I'd always take him to the cleaners in the end. But he never suspected nothing. All he'd say was, "Gosh, Erie, no wonder you took up gambling. You sure were born lucky." Can you beat that? Of course, like I said, it was only a gag. I mean, we played with real jacks just to make it look real, but it was all my jack. Huey never had no jack. His wife dealt him 4 bits a day for spending money. So I'd stake him at the start to half what I had, see? Chicken feed, I mean. We'd pretend a cent was a buck and a nickel was a fin and so on, huh? Oh, that was some big game. He got a big kick out of it. He'd get all head up. Give me a kick, too, especially when he'd say, "Gosh, Erie, I don't wonder you never worry about money with your luck." I can't believe anything. Of course, I stole him off when he wanted to shoot nights. I didn't have a goddamn nickel. Ah, what laughs he used to hand me. He always called the horses the bang tails like he'd known them all his life. He'd never even seen a racehorse. Not until I kidnapped him one day and took him on down to Belmont. Oh, what a kick he got out of that. I was scared he'd pass out with the excitement. And he wasn't doing no betting either. All he had was 4 bits. It was just the track and the crowd and the horses that got him. Mostly the horses. You know, it's funny how a dumb, simple guy like Huey can all of a sudden get something right. He says, "They're the most beautiful things in the world, I think." And he wins. I tell you, pal, I'd rather sleep in the same stall with old man of war than make the whole damn Follies. What do you think?
Hmm? Oh, yeah, I agree with you, Mr. Smith. I mean, Erie.
Oh, yeah? Well, I bet you never seen one either, except back at the old fairgrounds in the sticks. I don't mean that kind of turtles. I mean a real horse.
What do horses have to do with anything? No matter what does anything have to do with anything.
And what do you think happened the next night? Damned if Huey didn't dig $2 out of his pants and try to slip into me. Let this ride on the nose of whatever horse you're betting tomorrow, he told me. Well, I got sore. "Nix," I said. "If you're going to start playing sucker and betting on horse races, you don't get no assist from me." Was that a laugh, huh? Me advising a sucker not to bet when I spent most of my life telling saps the story to make him bet. I said, "Why'd you grab this dough out of the little woman's purse, huh? What tale you gonna give her when you lose it all? She'll start breaking up the furniture with you." "No," he says, "she'll just cry." "Well, that's worse," I said. "No guy can beat that racket. I had a doll cry on me once in a restaurant full of people till I had to promise her a diamond engagement ring to sober her up." Well, anyway, Huey sneaked $2 back in the little woman's purse and went home that night. And that was the end of that. Boy Scouts got nothing on me, pal, when it comes to good deeds. That was one I'd done. Too bad I can't remember no others. You know, I had Huey size up for a sap the first time I seen him. Yeah, I just rolled in from Tijuana. Made a big killing down there. I was lousy with Jack. Came all the way in a drawing room, and I wasn't lonely in it, neither. There was one of those blonde movie dolls on the train.
Yeah, I was lucky in them days. I used to follow the horses south every winter. I don't know more. Sick of traveling. And I ain't as lucky as I was. That anyway, this time I'm talking about. As soon as I hit this lobby, I see there's a new night clerk. And while I'm signing up for the bridal suites, I make a little bet with myself that he's never been nothing but a night clerk. And I win. Oh, he wouldn't open up at first. Not that he was cagey about gabbing too much, but like he couldn't think of nothing about himself that was worth saying. But after he'd seen me roll in here the last one every night, and I stopped to kid him along and tell him the tale of what I'd win that day, he got friendly and he talked. Came from a hick burg upstate. Graduated high school there and had a shot at different jobs in the old hometown, but couldn't make the grade until he was took on as a night clerk in a hotel there. Oh, that he made good. But he wasn't satisfied. Didn't like being night clerk in the town where everybody knew him. So he'd read somewhere in the sucker's almanac, I guess. All the guy had to do was to come to the big town, and old man's success would be waiting at the Grand Central, giving the key to the city. What a gag that is, huh? Even I believed that once, and no one ever called me sucker. But anyway, made the break, come here, and the only job he could get... night clerk. Then he fell in love, or kidded himself he was, and got married. Met her on a subway train. Stopped sudden, and she was jerked into him, and he put his arms around her, and they started talking, and the poor boob never stood a chance. She was a sales girl in some punk department store. Sick of standing on her dogs all day and all the way home to Brooklyn, too. So, the way I figure it, knowing Huey and Dames, she proposed, said yes for him, and married him. And after that, of course, he never dared stop being night clerk, even if he could. Hey, maybe you think I ain't giving her a square shake, huh? Well, maybe I ain't. Never gave me one. Put me down for a bad influence and let her chips ride. And maybe Huey couldn't have done no better. Dolls didn't call him no riot. Huey and her seemed happy enough the time they had me out to their flat. Well, not happy. Maybe contented. No. No, that's boosting it. Resign comes nearer. As if each was giving the other a break by thinking, well, what more could I expect? How do you and your little woman hit it off, brother?
If those cops would only shoot it out with a gunman some night. Nothing exciting has ever happened on any night I've lived through. Oh, guy, you mean my wife? Well, we got along all right, I guess.
Better lay off them headache pills, pal. The first thing you know, some guy's gonna call you dope.
Is daylight coming? Oh, it's too early yet.
Well, keep hoping, pal. Huey was as big a dope as you until I gave him some interest in life. That time he took me home to dinner. What a knockout. Took him a hell of a while to get up nerve to ask me. Sure, Huey, I told him I'd be tickled to death. I was thinking I'd rather be shot. For one thing, he lived in Brooklyn, and I'd sooner take a trip to China. Another thing, I'm a guy that likes to eat what I order and not what somebody deals me. And he had kids and a wife and that family racket is out of my line. But Huey looked so tickled I couldn't Welsh on him. And it didn't work out so bad. Of course, what he called home was only a dump of a cheap flat. Still, it wasn't so bad for a change. His wife had done a lot of stuff to doll it up. Nothing with no real clash to stand, just cheap stuff to make it comfortable. Kids wasn't the gorillas I expected, neither. No throwing spitballs in my soup and them kind of gags. They was quiet, like you. Yeah, I kind of liked them. So, after dinner, I started telling them a story about a racehorse a guy I know owned once. I thought it was up to me to
put out something, and kids like animal stories, and this one was true at that. Now, this old turtle, see, never wins a race, but he is as foxy as 10 guys. A natural-born crook, the goddamnest thief. He'd steal anything in reach that wasn't nailed down. I didn't get far. Huey's wife butt in and stopped me cold. Told the kids it was bedtime and hustled them off like I was giving them the measles. Got my goat, kind of. Yeah, could have liked her. A little, if she'd give me a chance. Not that she was nothing Ziegfeld would want to glorify. When you call her plain, you give her all the breaks. Oh, well, the hell with it. She had me tagged for a bum, and seeing me made her sure she was right. You can bet she told Huey never invite me again, and he never did. He tried to apologize, but I shut him up quick. He says, her mama's brought up strict. She can't help being narrow-minded about gamblers. I said, well, what's it to me? I don't want to hear your dame troubles. I got plenty of my own. Remember that doll I brung home night before last? She gives me an argument. I promised her $10. I told her, listen, baby, I got an impediment in my speech. Maybe it sounded like 10, but it was 2, and that's all you get. Hell, I don't want to buy your soul. What would I do with it? Now she's peddling the news along Broadway. I'm a rat and a chiseler. And, of course, all the rats and chiselers believe her. Before she's through, I won't have a friend left. I switched the subject on Huey, see, on purpose. He never did beef to me about his wife again. Believe me, pal, I can stop guys that start telling me their family troubles.
Going down 6. Will he die, Doctor? Or isn't he lucky?
No, I'm afraid not, but he'll have to be absolutely quiet for months and months.
With a pretty nurse taking care of him?
Probably not pretty. Well, anyway, I say he's lucky.
Yeah, that's a good one, Harry. Yeah, that's the best one I heard in a long time.
Jesus. This sure is a dead dump. About as homey as the morgue. Getting late. Better beat it up to my cell and grab some shut-eye. Hey, why didn't you tell me you was deep, buddy? I know guys are sensitive about them little afflictions, but I'll keep it confidential.
A fireman's life must be exciting.
Where's the fire? Is it a good one this time? Did it have a good start? Will it be big enough, do you think?
Take my tip, pal, and don't never try to buy from a dope peddler. He'll tell you you had enough already.
I mean, big enough to burn down the whole damn city? Sorry, brother, but there's no chance. There's too much stone and steel. There'll always be something left. Yeah, I guess you're right. There's too much stone and steel.
I wasn't really hoping, anyway. Doesn't really matter to me.
Well, me for the hay. Christ. It's lonely. I wish Huey were here. By God, if he was, I'd tell him a tale that would make his eyes pop. And the bigger the story, the harder he'd fall. It was that kind of a sap. He thought gambling was romantic. I guess he saw me like a sort of dream guy. Sort of guy he'd like to be if he could have took a chance. I guess he led the sort of double life. Listen to me gabbing about hitting the high spots. Come to figure it, I'll bet he even cheated on his wife that way, using me and my dolls. No wonder he liked me, huh? Yeah. The bigger I made myself, the more he lapped it up. Oh, I went easy on him at first. I didn't lie. Not any more than a guy naturally does when he gabs about the bets he wins and the dolls he's made, but I soon see that he's crying for more, and when a sucker cries for more, you're a dope if you don't let him have it. Every tramp I made got to be a Follies doll. Huey liked them to be Follies dolls, or the Scandals, or the Frolics. He wanted me to be the Sheik of Araby, or something any blonde would go round-heeled about. Well, I give him plenty of that. I give him plenty of gambling tales. I explained my camping in this dump was because I don't want to waste Jack on nothing but gambling. It's like dope to me, I told him. I couldn't quit. Then he lapped that up. He liked to kid himself. I'm mixed up in the racket, too. Yeah, he thought gangsters was romantic. So I fed him some baloney about hijacking I'd done once. I told him I knew all the big shots. Well, so I do, most of them. Say hello, and sometimes they say hello back, and, well, who wouldn't know them? It hangs around Broadway in the joints. I run little errands for them sometimes because there's dough in it. But, you see, I'm cagey about getting in where it ain't healthy. Huey wanted to think that me and Legs Diamond was old pals, so I give him that, too. I give him anything he cried for. Don't get me wrong, pal. What I fed Huey wasn't all lies. Them tales about gambling wasn't. They were stories of big games and killings that really happened since I've been hanging around. Only I wasn't in on them, like I made out. Except one or two from way back, when I had a run of big luck and was in the bucks for a while, before I got took to the cleaners. Yeah. Huey lapped up my stories like they was duck soup or a beak full of heroin. I sure took them around with me in tails and showed them one hell of a time. And you know, it done me good too, in a way. Sure, I'd get to seeing myself like he seen me. Some nights I'd come back here without a buck, feeling lower than a snake's belly. And the first thing you know, I'd be lousy with Jack betting a grand a race. Oh, I was wise. I was kidding myself. I'm not a sap, but what the hell? Huey loved it. And it didn't cost nobody nothing. And if every guy along Broadway who kids himself was to drop dead, there wouldn't be nobody left. Ain't it the truth, Charlie?
Hmm? Truth? I'm afraid I didn't get what... What's the truth?
Nothing, pal. Not a thing.
I should pay $4.92 more attention. After all, he's company. He's awake and alive. I should use him to help me live through the night. What's he been talking about? He must have heard some of it without meaning to.
I could tell by Huey's face before he went to the hospital he was through. I've seen the same look on guys' faces when they knew they was on the spot. Just before guys caught up with him. I went to see him twice in the hospital. First time, his wife was there and gave me a dirty look. But he cooked up a smile and he said, "Hello, Erie. How the bangtails treat you?" I see he wants a big story to cheer him, but his wife butts in and says he's weak and he mustn't get excited. I felt like cracking, "Well, the docs in this dump got the right dope. Just leave you with him and he'll never get excited." Well, the second time I went, They wouldn't let me see him. That was near the end. I went to his funeral, too. There wasn't nobody there, except a couple of his wife's relations. I feel sorry for her, too. She looked like she ought to be parked in a coffin, too. The kids was bawling. And there wasn't no flowers, except a couple of lousy wreaths. So I'd been a punk showing for old Huey if it hadn't been for my flower piece. Oh, that was some display, pal. Knock your eye out. Set me back $100 and no kidding. A big horseshoe of red roses. I knew Huey'd want a horseshoe because that made it look like he'd been a horse player. And around the top, printed in forget-me-not, was goodbye, old pal. Huey liked to kid himself he was my pal. So he was at that, even if he was a sucker.
What's he been talking about? He's been gassing for hours. What's he been telling me? I must be slipping. Always before this, I've been able to hear without even bothering to listen. But now, well, I've got it. Gambling. He said a lot about gambling. That's something I've always wanted to know more about, too. Maybe he's a professional gambler, like Arnold Rothstein.
I beg your pardon, Mr. Erie. But did I understand you to say that you're a gambler by profession? Do you by any chance know the big shot, Arnold Rothstein?
Christ, I wish Huey was alive and kicking. I'd tell him I win $10,000 from the bookies. $10,000 a stud, $10,000 in a crap game. I'd tell him I bought one of those big Mercedes sports roasters with nickel pipes sticking out the hood. I'd tell him I lay 3 babes from the Follies, 2 blondes and 1 brunette.
Arnold Rothstein. Oh, he must be some guy. I read a story about him. He'll gamble for any limit on anything and always wins. The story said he wouldn't even bother to play in a poker game unless the smallest bet you could make, one white chip, was $100. Christ, that's going some. I'd like to have the dough to get in a game with him once. The last pot, everyone would drop out but him and me. And I'd say, okay, Arnold, the sky's the limit. And I'd raise it $5,000. And he'd call, and I'd have a royal flush to his 4 aces. See, then I'd say, okay, Arnold, I'm a good sport. I'll give you a break. I'll cut you double or nothing, but just one cut. I want quick action for my dough. And I'd cut the ace of spades. And I'd win again.
Huey's better off at that being dead. He's got all the luck. He didn't do no worrying now. He's out of the racket. I mean, the whole goddamn racket. I mean, life.
Yes, it is a goddamn racket when you stop to think in 492. But we might as well make the best of it because, well, you can't burn it all down, can you? I mean, there's too much stone and steel. There'd always be something left to start it going again.
Say, what is this? What the hell are you talking about?
Well, I'll be frank, I really don't. It's just something that come into my head.
I'll get it out of your head quick, Charlie, or some guys in uniform will walk in here with a butterfly net and catch you. Hey, listen, pal. Maybe you guess I was kidding about that flower piece for Huey costing $100, huh? Well, I ain't kidding. I didn't give a damn what it cost. It was up to me to give Huey a big-time send-off because I knew nobody else would.
Oh, I'm not doubting your word, Huey. You wouldn't have any gambling, I suppose, huh? I beg your pardon if I'm mistaken, but you are a gambler, aren't you?
Yeah, sure. I got scratch to put up, what of it? But I don't win that $100, Charlie. I don't win a bet since Huey was took to the hospital. I had to get down on my knees and beg every guy I knew for a sawbuck here and a sawbuck there until I raised it.
Do you by any chance know Arnold Rothstein?
Arnold? What the hell's he got to do with it? He wouldn't loan a guy like me a nickel to save my grandmother from streetwalking.
Then you do know him?
Oh, sure, I know that bastard who don't on Broadway, and he knows me when he wants to. Uses me to run little errands for him when he ain't got no one else handy. But he ain't my trouble, pal. My trouble is that some of these guys I put the bite on is dead wrong G's, and they expect to be paid back next Tuesday. Or else I'm out of luck, and I have to take it on the lam, or I get beat up. Maybe sent to the hospital. Ah, but what the hell? I was wise, I was taking a chance. I always took a chance, and if I lose, I pay, and no welching. And it sure was worth it to give Huey the big-time send-off. But even that ain't my big worry, Charlie. My big worry is the run of bad luck I had since Huey got took to the hospital. Not a win. That ain't natural. I always been a lucky guy, lucky enough to get by and pay up on me. I'd never worry about owing guys the way I owe them guys. I'd always know I'd make a win that would fix it, but now I got a lousy hunch. When I lost Huey, I lost my luck. I mean, I've lost the old confidence. He used to give me confidence. No use gabbing here all night. You can't do me no good.
Just a minute, Harry, if you don't mind. So you're an old friend of Arnold Rothstein, huh? Would you mind telling me if it's really true when Arnold Rothstein plays poker, one white chip is $100?
For Christ's sake, what's it to you?
Say, Charlie, why didn't you put me wise before you was interested in gambling? Hell, I got you all wrong, pal. I've been telling myself this guy ain't like old you. He ain't got no sporting blood. He's just a dope. But now I see. You're a right guy. Sake. That's the stuff. Yeah. You and me will get along fine. Hey, I'll give you all the breaks like I give Huey.
Thank you, Harry. Is it true when Arnold Rothstein plays poker, one white chip?
Set you back $100? Sure. Why not? Arnold's in the bucks, ain't he? And when you're in the bucks, a C-note is chicken feet.
I don't know, pal. I was in the box when Arnold was a piker. Well, one time down in New Orleans, I lit a cigar with a C note, eh, just for a gag. I was with a bunch of high-class dolls, and I wanted to see their eyes pop out, and believe me, brother, they sure popped. After that, I could have made them one at a time or all together. Hell, you know, I once went $20,000 on a single race. That's action. A good crap game's action, too. Hell, I've been in games where there was $100,000 in real folding money lying around the floor. That's traveling. Of course, I wouldn't kid you. I'm not in the bucks now, you know. No, not right at this moment. You know how it is, Charlie. You're down today and up tomorrow. I got some dough, though, riding on the nose of a turtle in the fourth at Saratoga. I hear a story that he's so full of hop, if the jock can keep from jumping over the grandstand, he wins by a mile. So, I roll in here with a blunt that'll knock your eyes out. Don't be surprised.
Oh, you can't surprise me that way. I've been a night clerk in New York my whole life, almost. I'll forget the house rules, Erie.
Yeah, the manager wouldn't like you to remember something he ain't heard of yet.
Huh?
Oh! Hey, how about shoot a little crap, Charlie?
Huh?
Yeah, I mean, just in fun, like I used to with Huey. I know you can't afford to take no chances, so I'll stake you, see? I got a couple of bucks. You know, we gotta use a real jack, or it don't look real. But so am I, Jack, get it? Huh? You can't lose. I just want to show you how I'll take you to the cleaners. It'll give me confidence. Here you are. You want to give these dice the once-over before we start?
Well, what do you think I am? I know I can trust you.
Oh, you remind me a lot of Huey, pal. He always trusted me. Don't blame me if I'm lucky. You know, it's time I quit carrying the torch for Huey. Yeah, what's the use? Don't do him no good. He's gone, like we all gotta go. Him yesterday, me and you tomorrow, and who cares, and what's the difference? It's all in the racket, huh? I shoot two bits.
I fade you.
Four is my point. Oh, easy, when you got my luck and know-how, Charlie.
That was Huey by Eugene O'Neill. Directed by Jose Quintero, with Jason Robards as Erie and Jack Dodson as the night clerk. The sound design was by Randy Tom. Recorded at Skywalker North Studios, with production and engineering assistance by Dennis Leonard, Sharon Tom, Kent Brown, and Jim McKee. Here now is Travis Bogard, artistic director for this series, with a brief commentary about the play.
Toward the end of his creative life, as an uncontrollable dreamer with increasing frequency made his writing impossible, Eugene O'Neill drove himself to complete a work of extraordinary magnitude. An 11-play cycle of the history of the United States from pre-revolutionary times to the then-present, the mid-1930s. The drafts of the plays of the cycle, which he called A Tale of Possessors Self-Dispossessed, grew to inordinate lengths. They seemed to grow by themselves, he said, and for several years he fought without success to make his play of the generations theatrically fit. Only A Touch of the Poet was completed. Other drafts were destroyed when O'Neill realized he would not live to finish the work. In the midst of what were cruel, creative labors, three other more personal plays thrust their way to the forefront of his activity, plays that were to become his masterworks, The Iceman Cometh, and the autobiographical Long Day's Journey into Night, and A Moon for the Misbegotten. In these plays, he turned back to the tragic story of his early years and revealed the family truths which had always haunted him, perhaps giving depth to most of his writing. To write of his secret life, to exorcise the ghosts of his past, was surely a daunting experience, and, like the long cycle, demanded all the strength he could call on to bring the works to completion. It may have been as a reaction to these labors that he turned briefly away to write a play that is, in effect, a poem of the theater. He had always wanted to be a poet, but felt that he was only touched with poetry, a desire he could not fulfill. Yet now, as life's walls closed in on him. His secure knowledge of the theater's necessity made it possible for him to create a work that was poetry, not by its verbal beauty alone, but by its use of all the image-making elements of theater, lights, sound, dialect, and characterization. A work that became, when acted, a true poem of the stage. Reminiscent of the work of the Irish dramatist J.M. Singh, whose Riders of the Sea had once influenced his first dramatic efforts. In the midst of writing the autobiographical and historical works, he also planned a short cycle of one-act plays to which he gave the title By Way of Obit. Huey is the only one of the plays to have been completed, and little is known of the others except that one was to concern an Irish scrubwoman. All the plays, presumably, were to center, as Huey does, around a long monologue, a technique which from the time of the Emperor Jones forward had been a characteristic of O'Neill's dramatic style. In a measure, in planning By Way of Obit, O'Neill was returning to his point of departure as a dramatist. His career had begun with one-act plays, those concerning the crew of the SS Glencairn, which he wrote for the Provincetown Playhouse on Cape Cod in the second decade of the century. Now, nearly 30 years later, in 1944, at Dow House in California, he again took up the one-act play form. Compared with the unusually long plays like The Iceman Cometh and the marathon length of the cycle, the short Huey was compassable, and it avoided the painful introspection of the autobiographical plays. Writing it must have been a relief. The play which Huey most resembles is The Iceman Cometh, O'Neill's lengthy, detailed exploration of the lower depths, where the drunks in a down-at-the-heel saloon live without hope, with nothing to sustain them except their lying dreams. Huey, however, limits the perspective, and with great simplicity draws the picture of two lost souls thrown together in the dead of night in a city that is like an Isle of the Dead, haunted, full of terrors, offering nothing by way of shelter or solace. When Erie Smith, the small-time gambler, enters the dirty lobby of the rundown hotel, he's a fugitive. Not only from the men from whom he has borrowed the price of the elaborate funeral wreath for his dead friend, the former night clerk Huey, but from the night itself and the ambient hostility of the city whose sounds can be intermittently heard. No one, since his friend died, knows him. No one cares for him. And he must run. Like a blind man in a desert, he reaches out, but he can touch nothing, find no one. The hotel lobby is the only light in the vast emptiness of his life, and it, Huey being dead, can offer him nothing. In the past, the fake dice game he and Huey played allowed him to make contact with someone. This alone, this touching of another human being, assured him of his humanity and gave him the sense of being alive. Erie calls that sense confidence, by which he means the value that wards off the final victory of the hostile dark. But Huey is dead, and nothing now fills the void. The cage-like door of the elevator which he must take to go to his room is like a trap, and he cannot bring himself to walk into it. To enter his room is to die. All he can do is talk with empty bragging and meaningless autobiography, anything to maintain the movement that gives him the sense of being alive. He clutches his room key as if it were a fetish, a charm against the threatening night. His monologue beats against the silence of the new night clerk. His words spatter and drain away. The clerk sits silent, outwardly impassive, but inwardly turbulent with petty resentment and rages against a world that has found him useless. The clerk has no wish, no dream, not even the fears that stir Erie to animation. Only at the end, when Erie's outreaching words find a way through a crack in his impassivity, does life show in his silence. In Arnold Rothstein's poker game, is one white chip worth $100? The question, the only response the clerk makes to all that Erie has said, comes to Erie like a saving revelation. The lying dice game is restored, and improbably the two have found a way to assure one another that they are alive and that life can continue even at this low ebb. Carlotta O'Neill, O'Neill's wife, once said to me, when I called the boy gets girl ending of Anna Christie happy, "You must never use the word happiness when you speak of O'Neill." But the ending of Huey, if not in the usual theatrical sense happy, is one of the most gratifying in the theater, a positive, and despite all contrary evidence, a life-affirming moment, a fit conclusion to a rare piece of theatrical poetry.
That was Travis Bogard discussing Huey by Eugene O'Neill. This program was produced by Bay Area Radio Drama, Executive Director Eric Bowersfeld.